Evolutionist Sir Fred Hoyle.
I don't know what you mean by evolutionist, but Fred Hoyle was an astronomer.
Stated, and I quote, that believing that the first cell arrived by chance and accident is like believing that a tornado could sweep through a junkyard and create a Boeing 747.
First of all, Fred Hoyle was a dick. Secondly, he was no biologist. Third, you've taken that quote out of context. And fourth, and most importantly, I don't know anyone who's ever claimed that organic chemistry was random or accidental. Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here with her coffee. Come on in and grab yourself a cup. We're going to talk about YouTube and YouTubers. And I know what you want to hear. Who won last week's Dim Bulb of the Week? As you may recall, I left it up to you, the viewer, to choose last week's winner. Before we get to the winner, let's review our nominees.
I disagree with these experts. Somebody's got to stand up to experts.
Marriage is an institution of civil society, and no one in government has a right to redefine it.
Matthew Shepard was gay. Matthew Shepard was murdered by these two boys, but it was a drug deal gone bad.
A lot of people have called us at Live Action brave, but I want to tell you about a girl that inspires me who I think is very brave, truly brave. Her name is Malala. You may have heard of her.
But folks, I also do not apologize for being a Bible-believing Christian.
Some say that this is nothing more than an effort to impose mine or your or anybody's religious values on others.
And the winner, by an enormous margin of about 5-1, is Don McElroy. Congratulations, Don. You were last week's Dim Bulb of the Week.
Were you born an asshole? Or did you work it in your whole life? Either way, it worked out fine.
Where but in America could such an insignificant little toad as Don McElroy have such a pernicious impact on public policy? Now then, some of you may be disappointed that your preferred candidate did not win. Not to worry. Every single one of them deserves a Dim Bulb of the Week, and every single one of them is a blowhard who never shuts up. So no doubt, they'll have ample opportunity in the near future for their own Dim Bulb of the Week. Pardon me, but I forgot to proudly don my St. Louis Cardinals hat. Yes, they're going to the World Series once again. Now, in deference to so many of you who complain bitterly when I talk about sports, that will probably be my only mention of a sport today. Okay, so I lied. Sue me! Alrighty, before I move on, I want to mention some books I just purchased. It may be a while before I do any book reviews because I have a lot of reading in store. Went a little crazy in the bookstore on Friday. First book I want to mention is 12 Years a Slave, a reminiscence by Solomon Northrup, now a major motion picture, which, much to my chagrin, did not open here this weekend. The second book I purchased, and one I'm looking forward to with great anticipation, is Volume 2. Of the autobiography of Mark Twain. When Samuel Clemens, a.k.a. Mark Twain, died in 1910, he had completed his autobiography, but specified that it could not be published until 100 years following his demise. Volume 1 was fascinating. One of the more interesting things about the autobiography is that it is not in chronological order. The third book I purchased, and the one I'm currently reading, is Roosevelt's Second Act, and this concerns Franklin Roosevelt's decision to violate a long-held tradition and run for for a third presidential term. I've always found Roosevelt to be the most fascinating American president. Okay, I'm back. It's early evening. The sun is just going down. I did the first part of this video early this morning and then went out and enjoyed the fall weather and the North Carolina State Fair. I highly recommend it if you're ever in North Carolina in late October. Moving on, we've considered last week's dim bulb, but I think we have more business at hand. Past few weeks, a number of you have mentioned Trey Smith, our first nominee. He opened our show, and I've watched a bit of his work. He's apparently a commonplace con man, attempting to cash in on creationism and New Age woo-woo simultaneously. Smith has a website where he promotes his tawdry pseudo-documentaries and cheesy self-published books. Apparently, he's doing quite well. In terms of his creationist videos, let's see what Trey has to say.
Evolution does also appear to defy entropy, the second law of thermodynamics, that things decline over time.
How many times have we heard that one? And how many times has it been explained to people like Trey Smith that the second law of thermodynamics has nothing to do with anything declining over time?
Evolution also violates biogenesis, which states, of course, that life only comes from other life.
There's no such thing as a scientific law of biogenesis that asserts that organic chemistry cannot lead to the emergence of self-replicating organic compounds. Trey Smith, like many a creationist before him, has confused biogenesis and spontaneous generation, the idea that flies spontaneously emerge from rotten meat. I think you get the idea, and I won't make you suffer through his video any further. It's over an hour long, by the way, and I did watch a bit more of it until it exceeded my gag threshold. It's every single bad creationist argument you've ever heard. It's sort of like listening to Kent Hovind without the sense of humor and with an insufferable soundtrack. Trey Smith is a former associate of alleged faith healer and failed prophet Benny Hinn. Don't know who he is? Let me show you.
He is one of the most popular personalities in the evangelical world.
Tonight is your night for a miracle.
And one of the most controversial, and whether he's on his daily TV show.
Someone has just been healed of cancer, stomach cancer.
Receive the fire of the Holy Ghost.
Trey Smith's connection to that loathsome creature is a curious coincidence because our next nominee is also a former associate of the unspeakable Mr. Hinn. The intellectual, if I can use that term, godfather of the recent government shutdown, which by the way cost American taxpayers about $24 billion, was Senator Ted Cruz of Texas. And believe it or not, he's not our nominee today. Many of you, during that unfortunate sequence of events, may have wondered, what the hell is wrong with that guy? I believe I know the answer. Senator Ted Cruz's father, Rafael Cruz, is an extreme far-right fundamentalist preacher who was co-founder of Purifying Fire International Ministries with Benny Hinn's ex-wife. Rafael Cruz and his son Ted are Christian dominionists. I explained dominionism to you recently. They literally believe that they have a mission from God to take over the entire world and rule until Jesus returns. I'm not making that up. They're insane.
That God is looking at the church and everyone in it and deciding
in the next 3.5 years who will be his bankers.
God's people and his kingdom will begin to rule and reign. I know that's why God got Raphael's son elected.
We will become so blessed that we will usher in the coming of the Messiah.
Thank you. Thank you. It is such an honor.
The wealth of the wicked is stored for the righteous. And it is through the kings anointed to take dominion that that transfer of wealth is going to occur. God has given you an anointing to go to the battlefield. The battlefield is the marketplace. To go to the marketplace and occupy the land.
I believe Raphael is suggesting that Christians should spend less time building up their riches in heaven and more time grabbing it down here. Not much of a contest today. Our contest is between a really cheap, run-of-the-mill con man and one scary son of a bitch.
Were you born an asshole? Or did you work it in your whole life? Either way, it worked out fine. Cause you're an asshole tonight.
Well, I wish I could close with a joke. But those guys are a big downer. Bis später.